Thank you all for carving out some time for attending today's webinar on business leadership in VUCA world. To all the attendees out there, please type in any questions you might have in the Q&A section and we'll try to answer as many as possible at the end of the session. I would now like to introduce our speaker. A combat veteran of the Indian Army commanded 18 Grenadiers, the battalion that captured Tiger Hill, successfully transited to higher education industry, and now a certified business growth expert and coach from world's largest business coaching company, Action Coach. Adding some more feathers to his cap, he is qualified in electronics, cyber, and psychological warfare, qualified in media communication and management, has extensive combat experience in all types of terrains, including Siachen Glacier, Line of Control, Thar Desert, and the Run of Kutch. He is passionate about developing effective teams and organizations focused on delivery. He firmly believes that improvements and enhancements are possible across existing models and systems and is keen as a student and practitioner of disruption through innovation and out-of-the-box thinking. With that being said, I would now like to welcome Colonel Rahul Sharma. Welcome, Rahul.
Yeah. Thank you, Sonali. Thank you so much for your introduction. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this webinar on business leadership in VUCA world. I'll start by sharing my screen. Okay, so good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this webinar, business leadership in VUCA world. What is VUCA? Now, VUCA is an acronym. It's four alphabets, V, U, C, and A. They stand for volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity. I call them the four wild horses of the VUCA world. The next question is, where does this VUCA term come from? This acronym was coined by the US Army War College in the early 1990s. And the term became particularly popular in the US military after the shocking events of 9/11. Soon their armed forces entered into Afghanistan and Iraq and found themselves bogged in unconventional conflicts, where VUCA is the natural norm. It is in natural abundance. Now, the business community adopted this term when they had their own encounter with unprecedented VUCA chain of events started by the shocking collapse of Lehman Brothers in 2006 and 2008 financial crisis. In the last decade, this term has found resonance with increasing numbers of CEOs as they try to make sense of the constantly changing challenges brought on by politics, economics, society, and geopolitical tensions. Now today, we have the COVID-19 crisis, where we are dealing with a global pandemic, which is causing unprecedented economic disruption. For many business owners, the world has become topsy-turvy, and most are struggling to make sense of it. The four mad horses of VUCA seem to be on a rampage and they're causing havoc in our business. So let us begin this webinar by getting to know them. Before I do that, let me share some hygiene protocols for this webinar. We have a chat box and I'm hoping that we all use it to interact with each other. I shall be asking you questions that can be replied by a yes or a no. You could even type just a Y to represent a yes and an N to represent a no. But please do respond. I promise you that the more you participate, the more energized and motivated I will be to share more of my knowledge and my experience. That should surely raise your ROI on the time that you're going to invest here. We also have a Q&A box. Please type in your questions on any matter related to business. Sonali will monitor and consolidate all the questions. And I promise to devote at least 20 minutes to answering them, which means that I intend to finish my presentation in next 35 minutes. So let us begin with our presentation and our familiar introduction to the four components of VUCA. The first component of VUCA is V, which stands for volatility. Volatility refers to the speed of change in an industry, market, or the world in general. It is associated with fluctuations in demand, turbulence, and short time to markets. The more volatile the world is, the more and faster things change. Next is U, U for uncertainty. Now, this refers to the extent to which we can predict the future with confidence. The more uncertain the world is, the harder it is to predict. One more thing about uncertainty is that people's inability to understand what is going on contributes to this uncertainty and is also associated with it. The C in VUCA represents complexity. Complexity refers to the number of factors that we need to take into account, their variety and the relationships between them. The more these factors that we need to take into account, the greater their variety and the more they are interconnected, the more complex an environment is. Under high complexity, it is impossible to fully understand and analyze the environment and come to rational conclusions. In short, the more complex the world is, the harder it is to analyze. Sorry for the delay in the slide, so I'll stay here for a moment so that the audiences can have a look at it. Okay, finally comes A, which comes from ambiguity. A situation is ambiguous when information is incomplete, contradictory, or too inaccurate to draw clear conclusions. Ambiguity refers to a lack of clarity about how to interpret something. It makes decision-making highly challenging and risky. The more ambiguous the world is, the harder it is to interpret. Now, if we consider each of these in isolation, then a purely volatile environment, that is, it's volatile but not uncertain, complex, or ambiguous. In such a world, there's a lot of fast but predictable change. On the other hand, in a purely uncertain world, it is hard to tell how things gel up. And in a purely complex world, things are hard to untangle and understand. Finally, in a purely ambiguous world, things are just hard to discern. Now, in practice, the four terms are interrelated. For example, the more complex and volatile the industry is, the harder it is to predict. Therefore, it will be more uncertain. Yet all four represent distinct elements that make our environment. The world, a market, an industry, all these things where these four are present become harder to grasp and control. Often one of these appears and the others soon follow. They also strengthen, reinforce, and encourage each other in a kind of positive loop. So now that we have familiarized ourselves with these terms, it would be great if you were to share your thoughts about them. We have a poll in front of you where you have four questions, and I see you have already started answering those questions. Great. Now, what I intend to ask you was, how many of you do feel that this our own business world in the last 75 days has been more volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous? And I see majority of you agree with that aspect. More than 90% feel that our world, business world, has been turned into a VUCA world. Okay, so we can remove the poll, please. Can we have the results? Okay, so the poll, as you see it in front of you, the results are instantaneous, and we have more than 90% people saying that yes, our business world today is a VUCA world. Okay, great. Now you must be at this moment, I know what you're thinking. You must be saying to yourself, well, all this theory is fine, thank you. I learned four new words and concepts and horses, etc. But all that is theory. I want to learn how to deal with them in my own real world, right? That's what you're asking. So type a Y for a yes, and type a N for a no. So in case you're in agreement with what I'm saying, please type and let me have a look at what our people are saying in our chat box. Okay, great. So most of us would like to know practical ways of dealing with this. Theory is fine. Okay. So how do we survive in a VUCA environment? My take is that there is a lot that we can learn from Indian Army, which routinely operates in challenging VUCA environment and still accomplishes its mission with deadly efficiency. Now, I was commissioned into the Grenadiers Regiment in 1992, and I spent the next 21 years in combat leadership roles in operations from Siachen to the RAL. I led my troops in conventional, non-conventional, and counterterrorism operations, thriving and often enjoying myself in the fast-paced VUCA world. In fact, in that environment, while I was serving in the army in combat leadership role, normal was boring. It could be fatally boring. Now, I commanded my battalion, the 18th Battalion of the Grenadiers Regiment. And like Sonal told you, this battalion had the singular honor of capturing Tiger Hill during the Kargil War. After that, I hung my uniform and changed my attire. Today, in my new innings, as a business and performance coach, I frequently draw upon my extensive combat training and leadership experiences to help my clients. In the last 2 months, I've seen my clients use this input successfully to quickly pivot in response to the fast-changing scenarios. So here are some of the leadership tips for navigating the VUCA world ahead. I suggest that you get your writing material ready because you may like to take notes for future reference. Now, I shall limit myself to only four aspects of leadership. First will be mindset, then situational awareness, thereafter planning and execution, and finally team issues. Let us take mindset first. Now, you all will agree that our mind is a very powerful instrument. It can either be our ally or an opponent. As all of you would recall from Mahabharata, Lord Krishna gave his complete army to Duryodhana. Arjuna, on the other hand, only asked for Lord himself. And we know who won in that war. So it is with our mind. We win or lose depending on what side it chooses. Now, let me tell you a story. Okay. Military operations are often conducted in very difficult terrain, especially especially true with the Indian Army. Half the fight is against the natural elements. So let me share an incident. It is true. Yes, it is true. But a lot of details have been taken away for various security reasons, and I've sanitized it to an extent. So in one such operation, we got information that terrorists were present in their hideout, and this hideout was located on a massive mountain feature, which was covered with thick, dense forest. Now, we had to move in hours of darkness to maintain secrecy. The difficulty of the climb meant that it would be quite challenging. We would also have to keep moving throughout the night without any break. So we moved out from our base and we started climbing the mountain, and soon it started raining. It began as a slow drizzle at first, but soon it became heavy and was pouring buckets. The temperature dropped fast and water started creeping into and soaking every bit of clothing and equipment. The route became slippery and even more difficult to climb. Team members, they were slipping and falling, and it seemed almost impossible to continue to move. There was no way that we could reach our objective before first light, or that is at dawn. And everything seemed to be going against us. And then one of the guys had a terrible fall, so bad that he broke his leg, his tibia fibula, that is the bone in your shin. Now, what could we do? Worse, he also happened to be carrying only one long distance radio transmitter, which got damaged in the fall. Okay, so this was the situation. Now, what did What should we do? What could have we done? Okay. I'm going to highlight and use this situation to highlight certain aspects. The first thing is that in a VUCA world, where things are changing very fast, and most of them are not within your control, you have to begin by accepting the reality. Now, in this case, in my story, the situation was what it was. The mountain was not going anywhere. The rain would not go. It would go when the nature decided, and we could not influence that. Lastly, even with our best efforts, we were likely to miss the deadline. Now, what was that deadline and why it was important? It was important because if we could place ourselves in observation role before it was dawn, before the first light arrived, we had a reasonably good opportunity and possibility to locate this hideout, because the militants and the terrorists were expected to come out of the hideout in the morning hours to do their morning ablutions and such things. Now, if we were going to miss that deadline of reaching there in time to take that position, this operation was not likely to succeed. Okay, so all this was definitely frustrating. But was there any point in getting angry? Would cursing the mountain or the forest or the rain help? No. Similarly, in the corona situation, the situation as it exists today is what it is. We all wish that it were different, but it is what it is. So there's no point denying it, accept it. Now, that is the first step in responding effectively to any situation. Take a look, take a cold, objective look at what the situation is. Do not get emotional. Do not let your emotions come in the way in your analysis. The next thing is, do that, but avoid obsessing, which means what? While you're looking at the situation, don't let the situation overpower you. Don't let the information overpower you. No point obsessing, oh, it is raining, it is so cold, it is difficult to move. People are falling, we cannot reach in time. Now, these are all facts, but why obsess about them? You may say that this operation is doomed to failure. Why even try? It's a waste of effort, etc., etc. This is what happens when you start obsessing about your present problem. You cannot see a way around it or through it. And that doesn't help anyone. As a leader, you cannot do that. Never. Never ever should you do that. In fact, you have to make sure that others also do not go into that negative drive. In the present crisis also, do not obsess about the corona crisis. That's not going to help anyone. No matter the size of your business, you're the business leader. People depend on you and they're looking up to you to provide leadership and direction. Okay? So, the question is, what did I do? How did I embrace the reality and what did I do in order to not obsess about that reality? What I did was, I got the guys together. Okay? I told them exactly these very things. That, okay, the situation is bad, guys. This rain has made our operation difficult. We are not likely to reach our objective in time. We are not likely to make it in time. Okay? And that moment has become very difficult. We are falling around. And look at this guy. He has fallen. He has broken his leg. And our radio set is non-functional. It can no longer be used. Okay? So this is what I did. I had laid out the facts in front of them without any drama. Without any kind of drama. And taking cue from me as a leader, my troops, my team members, they also, who are feeling all bad and morose and everything, they also did not do any drama. They also controlled the emotion. Okay? So let us go ahead with the story as I bring out the other point. This is not the only thing that happened. Now, the other thing that happens in business scenario is that we become despondent. We let despair get at us because the things are difficult, right? Like in the present circumstances, the business scenario is very difficult at the moment. Now, my advice to you is that no matter what the challenges are in your business, you cannot allow them to overwhelm you. You cannot allow self-doubt to creep in. Do not let despair or fear overpower you and paralyze you. Let me tell you, a good soldier is always afraid. Okay? It is not that he is absolutely fearless. He has fear. But he does not let that fear paralyze him. He not only overcomes his fear, but he also channelizes it into explosive action. And action is the surest and the most effective antidote to doubts, despair, fear, confusion. What kind of action? I mean determined, focused, energetic action. And I tell you this with decades of combat experience behind me. In such circumstances, there is also a possibility of taking knee-jerk decisions. Don't give up at the slightest problem or obstacle to forward movement. When you come across such obstacles, you have to find the will and resources and means to go around them, over them, or through them. In the army, we say we persevere in face of adversity and hence we thrive in it. Okay? So, some of the things that I did. Not only did I get my team together, I also took a stock of the situation. One of my team members was badly injured. He had broken his leg. He could not move. We were not likely to reach in time. Okay? So the first option was to quit the operation. But I was not willing to do that because we had enemy in a certain location and it was my mission, it was our mission to go and neutralize that enemy. So we were not willing to give up so easily, not so soon, and we were still committed to continue with our mission. So that is the first thing, that whenever you come across such obstacles, you should not compromise on your mission. You should stay committed to it. Stay committed to the long term. Okay? The second thing that happened was that I decided that if we have to continue with this mission, the injured team member cannot go with us. And therefore, we decided to leave him there. Yes, we decided to leave him there. He's a trained soldier. So I'm taking stock of what he can do and the situation. So he's a trained soldier. He can stay there. He has his weapon and ammunition with him. He can take care of himself. In the meanwhile, I got in touch with my base on the wireless. Now, the long distance wireless was crashed and it could not be used, but we had certain short distance wirelesses and we were still within the range of our base. So we communicated with the short range wireless and I informed my superiors that this is what has happened. My CO said, Rahul, if you don't want to continue, it's your call. I said, no, sir. We'll do our best and let us see how it turns out. However, we're leaving operator or communication guy here, and he has one of these short range radio transmitters. I'll request you to kindly send two people here with a stretcher, and when we are coming down, we'll carry him along with us. So those two people can come and stay with him. Please do not send an ambulance because that would alert people around all along the route that something is happening. So please send a small party of 2 to 4 people who can come and take care of this person till we return. The next thing that we did was we decided to create wooden staffs. So we cut the branches from the pine trees, straight branches. Pine trees thankfully have very straight branches. And then we chopped and sharpened one of the ends. So that now this sharp end was used to stabilize us by digging it into that wet mud. Now this increased our mobility.
Sorry, I don't know how to do that yet.
I'm sorry for this. So because of this, now we were able to move better. People stopped slipping around. We had a support, two such large staffs or long staffs in our hands, which had pointy ends, and we could use the pointy ends to stabilize ourselves. Okay. So instead of giving in, we decided to continue. We looked at the situation. We created a solution from the resources that were available and overcame this problem of not being able to move. The problem of an injured teammate was taken care of by leaving him there and asking some support to come from the base to look after him till we return. Now, a knee-jerk reaction could have been that we could have stopped there and waited for, let's say, the rain to stop. We could have given up on the operation completely. We could have just walked back to our base. But we looked at the situation, the resources, the possibilities, options, and selected that one that was most conducive to accomplishing our mission. Now, ever since the lockdown started, we have been getting so much of information. We've been flooded with webinars, articles, videos, etc., which are advising business owners on what to do. My take is that please don't accept everything and start implementing in your business. Avoid knee-jerk reactions. Somebody said we must cut cost, and people started cutting their manpower. Now, 2 months after the lockdown, today when we are in unlock stage, we require those people and we already let them go. We need people in order to run our business, and we need them even more today when we have to restart, revive, and rejuvenate our business. So you know your business better than anyone else, including its strengths, its weakness, and challenges. Listen to people, listen to advice, but take your own call. Do not take any knee-jerk reaction. Next is that stay in your three-foot world. That is, control what you can, ignore what you can't. Now, when this soldier of mine, he broke his leg. Now, this is a situation that I could not control. There's nothing I could do about it. But I did not let that compromise my mission. I created a solution. I looked at what I could do, and I focused only on that. When I left that soldier, I explained to him, do not worry. Be careful. You have your weapon, you have your ammunition. Stay here in your three-foot world, control what you can. Similarly, in coronavirus, in this corona pandemic, most of us are on edge. As leaders, whether it has been our business, families, or communities, it is our responsibility to focus on what we can control and then deprioritize, not prioritize, deprioritize those things that we cannot control. I could not control rain, I could not control the mountain, I could not control the forest, but the same forest gave me those stuff, those sticks, long sticks that I could, my team could use. And after my team member was injured, the same forest gave him cover, it protected him. Okay? The same mountain, we found a place for him to sit where which had a rocky overhang, and this person was safe from water and elements and wind and other elements. Okay, so where did that happen? It was from the same mountain that was creating so much of problem for us. So this is about the mindset. Embrace reality, avoid obsessing, don't let fear grip you, avoid knee-jerk reactions, don't dive into the bunker, that is, do not give up, don't run away from the situation. Stay in your three-foot world and control what you can. Finally, the most important thing about mindset is to be proactive. In all this, while my mind was working, it was also important to keep on thinking of possible actions. And once those possibilities started emerging, because I was thinking about them, I started evaluating those possibilities. I shortlisted, okay, these are the things that I can do, let me do this. And the moment I took that call, I explained that to my team, and we were actually doing it. We started acting on that. People moved towards, some people started helping this guy, the injured fellow, to get into a safe area. Others started chopping those branches and sharpening their ends. Somebody else was taking care of the communication aspect, checking on this radio set that has become kaput, and then also looking at other resources, other short-range radio sets that we had available with us. So all this is about being proactive. This also enthused my team and took their mind away from all the negativity, and they started focusing on how to accomplish the mission. They got confidence that yes, we are still operational, we are still going for the mission, we can still accomplish it. And that makes a huge difference. The next point is about situational awareness. Sorry, I skipped something. So this concept in Action Coach is very well illustrated in this idea. And this idea is called the point of power. What is this point of power? This is the point below which you do not take responsibility. And instead of doing that, you keep on blaming others, blame the situation, blame the circumstances, find excuses, and then be in a denial. There's nothing I can do. It's not my fault. Nothing can be done. When you're doing all these things, you're below your point of power. And that makes you powerless. It takes away your ability to respond. On the other hand, when you're above this point of power, what you do is you take responsibility. You hold yourself accountable for whatever is happening in your environment. And you own that environment. You own that battlefield. You own the situation. Okay? Now that brings me to the next part. From the situation comes the situational awareness. Because in order to own the situation, you need to be aware of it. The first thing is that you need information. During war, there's a lot of fog. Similarly, in a VUCA environment, where things are not clear, there's a lot of fog, there's a lot of uncertainty. You're not sure what is happening, what is not happening. You're not getting enough information. It could be a wrong information. So you need to pierce this fog of war. How do you do it? You do it by gathering appropriate ground intelligence, which is related to your near-term aspect of your business. And then you need to organize that data and use it to formulate a plan. So how do you gather this ground intelligence, which is appropriate to your business? If you're interested to know that, please type yes, and then I shall elaborate it. Otherwise, we can move ahead. Okay. Yes. Good. Right. So this is what you do. How do you gather this intelligence? There are various sources of intelligence gathering. I'm sharing my experiences from conflict zone, and I'll relate them to your business scenario. First is higher headquarters. What is higher headquarters? Now, higher headquarters, they have more information, more resources. They're being fed a lot of information from various agencies, and I need to be in touch with them. Okay. So before the start of the operation, we got the information from the higher headquarters. I had got in touch with them to confirm various aspects, to fill in the various gaps that I may have had. Now, in your case, in your business environment, what is the higher headquarters? Now, if you are a multi-locational company, your headquarter company, that is wherever your headquarter is there, that is your higher headquarter. In case you're a small business owner, where is your higher headquarter? You may not have a higher headquarter. You could be a 5-member team and you're the business owner. So where is this higher headquarter? In that case, what you do is you create one. You could create an advisory board of experienced people who give you advice. And you can go back to these people in this kind of situation as we are going through now and ask them, oh, this is what is happening. Can you help me? What should I do? You could also have mentors. Instead of having a formal board of advisor, you could have informal mentors, mentors who are mentoring you, or you could have coaches who coach you. So these are the people who give you information and share their experiences. They are more aware, they are more experienced, they have more resources at their disposal, and therefore they are always constantly following what is happening in the business world, and therefore they can give you information, they can give you insights, they can help you. The next is, in our case, it is electronic intelligence. That is information that are coming from electronic intercepts, radars, etc., etc. Okay, now that is technology driven. Well, in business now, you also have a lot of technology. Start using it. Use your network, network of people, network of friends, other business owners. Stay connected with them using the technology. Talk to them and they will tell you a lot of information. The second is the real ground intelligence that I get from my scout. So when I'm moving around, I have two people ahead of me who are doing the job of scouting. They are the ones who are moving around and trying to see what is ahead, how is, if there is any enemy. They keep on listening, they're keenly listening, trying to catch sounds, okay? Because at night when you're moving, you can't see farther, but you can hear farther, okay? So you can't see for long distance, but when you're hearing, you can hear farther. So this is what these scouts do. They're also my early warning elements who are able to tell me, give me an early warning. But just having them there is not enough. I also need to communicate with them. So after these two scouts, I'm the third guy, I'm right there. So I'm not at the back, I'm right behind these two scouts so that when they see something, they stop, they call me ahead. It doesn't take time, I reach there and I see for myself what is there. Okay? I take and I evaluate what the situation is. Now the question is, in your business, who are your scouts? Your scouts are all those people who are on the front line. Who are your frontline people? People who are dealing with the customers, the customer facing team members, those team members who are directly dealing with the vendors or the suppliers. Now, these are the two frontline troops who can tell you a lot of information about what is the customer attitude, how it is changing, how are the vendors handling the situation, what are the problems that they are facing. You need this information in order for your business to respond to this situation. If you do not have these resources, if you do not activate these resources for intelligence gathering, then you would have very little intelligence. It would be like you had put yourself inside a hole where you cannot see anything. So please activate this. And the fourth one is probing patrols. Now this is something that we use in static battlefield, where in order to know what is happening, what the enemy is doing, we send probes. We send people, small parties, which go and try and test the enemy's defenses so that we come to know what is happening. Okay? So these are, in your case, these probing patrols could be, you know, small little experiments that you do in order to find what is happening in the business environment. You could even ask your people, your salespeople, to actually find out from the market what is happening with your competitors, what your competitors are doing. Your salespeople and your vendor management guys, they also have contacts in other companies, including your competitors. So through an informal network of information, a lot of information can be gathered, right? Okay. So situational awareness. We have dealt with this piercing the fog by using various resources to find out the information. Now, once you have the information, you must verify it. You must verify, know the facts, okay? Trust the information or the resources who are giving you that information, but also verify. For example, when my scout would stop and tell me something on the walkie-talkie that something is there, there is some movement in front, or they have seen something suspicious, I would go in to them and see it for myself. Why? Not because I did not trust my scout, but by being there, I could get my own perspective, a better perspective rather than a relayed perspective. I could see exactly what it was and make my own assessments. Now, in the current situation, we have seen very wild and different statistics which have been floating around the digital universe. And we're getting varying information coming from various sources, including the official agencies. Now that is exactly of what people do not need right now. See, ambiguity already exists. Let us not fuel the fire by putting more ghee more oil into it. Okay, so let us not fuel the fire by putting more ghee and oil. What we should do instead is that go by facts, verify what we come to know, okay, and then take a call on what we need to do. How do you do that? The agile practitioners, they use a tool called OODA loop. Okay, you know, agile is it's a philosophy in software development. So they use this OODA loop, which again comes from military warfare. And I learned it during my pre-commission training at Indian Military Academy. What does it mean? Well, as you can see on the slide, this is again an acronym, and O stands for observe. Next O is oriented, then is D for decide, and A for act. What it means is that it is a cycle of actions. How do you take them? You observe your environment, you see what is happening, you pick up the relevant information that is important to you that can have an effect on your operations, okay? Then you orientate yourself, your plan, and your team to that situation as it is developing. You decide on an option that is best suited to your mission in the given circumstances. And having decided, you decide on a quick plan and act. So this is the OODA cycle: observe, orientate, decide, and act. Now, in a VUCA environment, you have to shorten this cycle. That means you do not take a lot of time in each of these steps, but you do the cycle again and again. So you reduce the time for one single cycle and keep on repeating the cycle and keep on modulating your responses. The next part that I would like to cover is about planning and execution. General Eisenhower, who later on went on to become the president of USA, he once said that no plan survives the first bullet. Yes, I agree with that, because I too have rarely been part of a combat mission where unforeseen circumstances did not arise, and where the original plan could be executed as it was. Okay, so every plan that I have used ever, there were requirements to make certain modifications. So then why plan at all? Now, please understand that the process of planning has great value for the leader. It allows the leader to systematically consider all relevant factors, unravel the relationships, and evaluate his options. He then selects one best option, develops it in detail, and then executes it and modulates it. In all this process, the leader gains a better understanding of his own business, the operating environment, and he develops a better rhythm when he actually executes that plan. That is why I spend significant time with my clients on these progressive planning and debriefing tools and techniques. So, do not dismiss a plan just because Eisenhower said that no plan survives the first bullet, okay? You can have an 80% plan, because there is no such thing as a 100% plan. Another US general, General Patton, said that a good plan violently executed now is better than a perfect plan next week. So what I say is that plan, but don't overdo it. Don't obsess over too many details and try to create a perfect plan. Create a short-term functional plan and start implementing it soonest. You can always tweak it as you go along and as the situation develops. Now, the story that I told you, in that we just had 2 hours to get ready and to plan. When we got that information, we did not tell our bosses, oh no, we need to plan and we need to take every factor into account. So maybe we'll launch this operation after 3 days. No, we launched within hours with complete preparation. Okay, so in this VUCA world, you will also have this instances where an opportunity will suddenly emerge. And if you are not ready to grab that opportunity, you will miss it. So get this mental agility, okay? Now create a short-term functional plan and start implementing it soonest. You can always tweak it as you go along and as the situation develops. I make a 90-day planning with my clients every quarter, and I help them execute it with complete sincerity. I mean, I make them execute it with complete sincerity. Now, at the beginning of the crisis, we terminated the existing plans and we moved to a new one. Now, this was a new plan that we immediately started creating for the lockdown period. 60 days into the plan, the lockdown was lifted and we had unlock one. So by then, we had already utilized the lockdown period to add tremendous value to our systems, processes, teams, and capabilities, all as per the plan that we made for the crisis. Okay, all in line with the changes that we anticipated would affect the business scenario once the lockdown was lifted. As a result, my clients were also better prepared to resume with determination and focus when Unlock One started. Now, once that started, we again made a quick 90-day plan to revive and thrive the businesses as early as possible. And I'm proud to tell you all the businesses are back on their feet. They're not completely recovered, but all of them have recovered more than 60%. The next thing about plan is that you should also monitor, evaluate, and adjust. Now, we all know about this agile philosophy in software development. One of the most implemented agile operating approaches is Scrum. It was co-created by Jeff Sutherland, who was a former Navy fighter pilot. Now, the Scrum approach emphasizes on rapid iteration, and it draws on Sutherland's experience of landing his fighter jet on aircraft carriers. Landing a fighter plane on an aircraft becomes extra challenging because of the heaving deck. As the aircraft carrier is a huge ship, well, while it moves forward, it also pitches up and down and rolls sideways due to the waves, due to the ocean waves. Now, when you see an aircraft carrier on a TV screen, the movement does not seem very significant, but in reality, it is in meters. So such a huge structure moving meters up and down or left and right, it has a lot of momentum. It has got a lot of energy, which is, if it were to collide with a fighter jet, it would swat that fighter jet like a fly. So as the aircraft approaches the carrier, the pilot, he sets a glide path to get the right angle and trajectory for the safe landing, but he continues to closely monitor his approach along with the movement of the deck as the deck is moving. And he nimbly adjusts as and when a complication arises due to the surging sea waves and the heaving deck. If he did not do that, he would crash into the deck. So it's a very difficult maneuver, but it is done, or it successfully, because the pilot is constantly monitoring and adjusting himself. Similarly, in times of rapid change, as today, one must keep adjusting one's approach until we achieve that safe landing. Now, this is done through rapid iteration. In order to do this rapid iteration, that is rapidly responding to changing situation and changing your own ways of doing your business, changing your plans, etc. For that to happen, you need fast and honest feedback between teams, from customers, from stakeholders, and it is very vital. Without that, this kind of adjustment, monitoring, evaluation, and adjustment is not possible. So look at that. Get in touch with your customers, other stakeholders. Get a feedback from them, an honest feedback. Be willing to listen. Ask them questions. And then modulate your responses, modulate your business in response to these feedback that you're getting. Next is, focus on your quick wins, but balance them with your long-term goals. Again, let me give an example from the military operations. Now, in battle, when we attack a defensive position, we do it in phases. In the first phase, we apply a certain amount of force, and then in second and third. So we allocate forces, or a portion of force to all these three phases, three or two, whatever number of phases that we may have for capturing an objective. But for the first phase, we allocate and apply more force than is necessary. We do this in order to ensure a quick capture of the objective, quick capture with lesser casualties. Now, this early success with less cost, it strengthens the spirit and raises the josh of the team, which is tasked for the subsequent phases. So this is what I recommend, that focus on quick wins, especially in difficult environments. Quick wins, they raise the morale. But when we do that, we never do this over-ensuring is never done at the cost of the overall battle plan, that is to capture the complete objective. So going back to my story, preparing those pointy staffs, they allowed my team to get over the frustrating problem of slipping, sliding, and falling. It gave them better control, allowed them to move faster. And then it raised their hopes of making it in time. The mission again became viable for them. They again got invested in that mission. Yahan ye karna hai. Let us do this. We can do it. So a small win had a tremendous effect on their morale and confidence. Similarly, in your business, please focus on quick wins and success in small increments. Okay, and balance that with your long-term planning and achievement. Do not leave your long-term vision. I'm not saying that at all. Okay. For COVID-19, life and safety first are naturally they are essential today. But as leaders, you also have to realize that medium to long-term goals are also important. So you have to prepare for them, for the post-crisis support and growth. This crisis will end sometime. Okay? Now that brings me to the next part, and that is keep preparing. Mike Tyson once said that everybody has a plan until they get punched in the face. That's right, absolutely right. But that does not mean that one should enter into a boxing match against Tyson without a plan, or against anyone for that matter. What it means is that you also have to go with sufficient preparation. Preparation that will prepare you to take that punch and yet remain standing on your two feet while sufficiently maintaining your wits to dodge the next one and even connect one of your own with such power that Tyson is also stopped in his tracks. That is why we must not only plan but also prepare, and we must prepare hard. Preparation is even more important than planning, because it is being prepared that allows you to execute. It allows you to respond. Now, there is a very common saying that when the going gets tough, the tough get going. Yeah. And in the last 2 months, I've seen this saying all over the social media. Everybody has been sending it to each other. But I say that's nonsense. My experience tells me that there is no such thing as tough. There is only well-trained and untrained, only prepared and unprepared. When the going gets tough, only the well-trained and the better prepared last. I've seen many a tough guy break down and cry like infant. Yes, when confronted with a heightened VUCA or a high velocity VUCA scenario. They thought that they were tough, but they did not train properly or practice enough or were not well-prepared. So train yourself and your people, prepare for the unfolding future. Be mentally agile to respond to the situations as they arise and evolve. Again, you know your business best. I'll keep on saying that. You know your business best, okay? The next part is shift fire and try new strategies. What does that mean? Okay, in Army, we say that we demand discipline, but we expect innovation. Shift fire and try new strategies means that run a few experiments to test your ideas or even your hunches. Do it on a small, manageable scale. See, the way we were doing business before Corona started, most of it is not valid anymore. So how do we do business today? We have to find ways. We have to experiment. And you can do this on a small, manageable scale. But please do test and measure as you go along so that you get a reasonably accurate feedback on your experiment. What works, what does not work, what needs to be tweaked. And if you have a coach or mentor, then you can run those ideas with them and get their perspective also. They can also guide you on how to set up those experiments. And what are the key parameters that should be tested and how you should test and measure them. So this is what is meant by shift, fire, and try new strategies. But you have to do it with discipline. Why? See, discipline makes a difference between success and failure. Discipline makes any execution successful. And without discipline, it's very difficult to execute any plan. Okay? So don't go all over the place trying every new idea that you know that you collide into, that you bump into. And create a process to test that idea, stick to that, and stay committed. Do not keep on shifting your focus. Aaj ye karna hai, kal wo, and some third day somebody else tells you something else and you start doing that. Do not do that. Okay? Use this time to rally your troops around these new ideas. Execute them on a small scale, but with sufficient seriousness, with sufficient discipline, and do it in a more professional manner. Test and measure. With that, I come to the next part, and that is team. The first thing is that you have to build trust and accountability. These are the two most important cultural pillars for high-performance teams. That never changes. In fact, in VUCA environments, they become profoundly more important. Now, every team has its certain core values and guiding principles. What are your team's core values and guiding principles? Have you defined them? Are you even aware in your own mind that these are my core values? This is what we stand for. For example, you would have gathered that one of the core values was that we don't give up. Okay, no matter how difficult the situation, we find a way. Accomplishment of mission takes priority over everything else. But that does not mean that people are not important. That's why we made sure that this one person who got injured, we shifted into a safe place, made sure that he was protected, that he had all the resources that he would require, his weapon, his ammunition, and everything else. And we also made sure that somebody was moving in to provide him the support that he needed from the base. But the core value was not compromised, and that was mission accomplishment. Now, within your teams, make sure that you have these core values very well sorted out. Everybody knows about them. And everybody is aligned on the supporting behaviors that are associated with these values. These values should be your beacon for navigating in the murky waters that we are currently in. Your teams should be well aware of these, and these core values must empower your teams. Because if they're not empowered, there's no point having these just as a list in your office or in your mind. Let me give you an example of, this is a commercial example. Southwest Airlines. Now they are famous for providing a structure to their staff, which is based on their culture and an operating model, which is aligned to their culture. So culture and the operating model are closely aligned. In the field, their staff members know what levers they can pull to respond to the current conditions. They even have a discretionary budget that allows them to solve challenges for customers. And they do it quickly without a supervisor's approval. Now this capability is one of the reasons why recently an analyst on Bloomberg, he gave the opinion that Southwest might be the airline which is best prepared to adapt and emerge successfully from the challenges of COVID-19. Now this is when everybody is saying that airline industry is doomed. In spite of those seriously negative predictions, this analyst says that if there is any airline that will come out of this, it will be Southwest. Because he knows how well the teams are empowered and how they're aligned. Now, when you do this, please ensure that the accountability mechanisms are also part of your short and long-term plan. Just empowering the teams is not enough. You have to have sufficient accountability mechanisms where you ask them. Okay? Balance realism with optimism. What do I mean by that? Okay, let me tell you something about World War II. In World War II, many Allied soldiers, they ended up in prisoners of war camp. And they faced really harrowing conditions and they were terribly treated. Many of them perished in captivity. Lacks of them. Now, it was observed that the optimists were the ones who perished first. Strange, right? That the optimist should perish first. These were the guys who were convinced that they would be released by Christmas or Easter or Thanksgiving. And they never acknowledged that the reality of the situation as it existed. So they were positively deluded. So optimism is good. Okay, it is definitely better than pessimism. But please don't overdo it. The challenges that you face need to be acknowledged. During a crisis, it is important to do plain talk with all the stakeholders. And when I'm saying all the stakeholders, in your case, it includes everyone. Your team, employees, customers, vendors, suppliers, everyone. It is particularly important to share with your team the challenges that lie ahead. Never downplay them. But at the same time, you should also provide hope in overcoming it, focusing on the path forward. That will help your team to come together to deliver on the vision. You're moving up the mountain, things are not working out. Everything was going topsy-turvy for us. Okay? I stopped my team, got them into a huddle, explained to them what it was, told them what could be done. So it was not just that I listed out the problems, I also told them that, listen guys, this is difficult. We are in a difficult situation, but we are going to go ahead. I know what we are going to do. This is what I'm going to do. So not only did I tell them the situation, but that I'm going to handle it. And I told them what I'm going to do, how I'm going to do, so that they had confidence in my leadership. That confidence boosted up their Josh. That's very important. Remember that. Okay, so give them the plain talk, tell them what are the challenges ahead, but then tell them, I have things under control. I have certain ideas, these are my ideas, this is how we are going to do it. And don't worry, I'm going to get you out of this. That's what leadership is about. Next, communicate. Top, down, bottom, up, all over. Now, this is always a big one. Even when everything is going as planned, you should communicate a lot. But in a crisis, when you get punched in the face, and when your team is feeling uneasy, battle fatigue is set in, people are losing their hope or losing their enthusiasm, that time communication becomes even more important. And it has to be done in an aligned fashion, aligned to the situation, to the team, to the mission. Don't worry about over-communicating them, okay? Now today, you are working remotely and remote work has become easier than ever before. Now, that's good. But the challenge is keeping everybody within your team feeling like they're part of one team and they're fighting one's fight and it's a good fight. You need to communicate this, okay? You need to foster an environment of psychological safety where everyone has a voice. But at the same time, do not shy away from saying the ugly truth. Okay? Do not shy away from chastising your employees who are not delivering or who are slacking. Now, when you decide on the communication, please make sure that it is well-rounded and focused on the big picture. So whenever during that operation, while we in that situation, whenever I communicated, I kept people in the loop. I shared all the information. But I kept them also focused on the big picture. And that big picture was what? That we have to go and get these terrorists. We are going to do it. We are going to accomplish this mission. We are not giving up until we have tried our best. So Please make sure that you have a specific communication strategy, and this specific communication strategy is also part of your 80% plan. It must focus adequately on all stakeholders in your business. I also communicated the relevant information to my headquarters. When my CEO said that, Rahul, if you wish, we can call it off, I again communicated to him, yes, the situation is bad. I have things under control. If I feel like that, we cannot move anymore, I'll take the decision and keep you informed. Because of this communication, the CEO also had confidence and he let me take that call. Okay? Now, when I say all stakeholders, I also include your family. Please communicate with your family also, since they are also a stakeholder in your career and business. Okay, so with this, I come to the end of the formal presentation. Let me tell you that I'm convinced that to survive and thrive in future, business leaders must necessarily graduate to a higher level of leadership and also agility in business operations. Instead of trying to control these four horses of VUCA world, we should learn to actively engage with them. Because let me tell you, they're not going anywhere soon. However, this will require a different mindset, a distinctive style of leadership, and higher levels of leadership agility. Let me re-emphasize here that you know your business better than anyone else. And you are the only one who has to make it work and thrive. No matter what the situation may be, you cannot run away from this responsibility. So you are the one who has to take on that leadership. Please look ahead and anticipate the unfolding situation. Now, you may not be able to look too far in the future, but make an attempt and prepare your business for whatever is likely to turn up in near future. Okay? Now, generally at this point, people would like to know, or they ask me, so what happened after that? What happened to your operation? In case you would like to know that, you can type a yes or a no, and I'll take that on after some time. In the meanwhile, let me tell you what you should be doing now, what you can do right now in your business. Okay? Based on my experiences, both as a combat leader and now as a business coach, I would like you to do these things. First, make a list of 10 of your biggest and most pressing challenges that you currently face in business. That is taking stock. Okay? Break each of them down into the components and subcomponents. Okay? What you're doing is you're defining the problem in as much detail as you can. Now you need information. Okay? So make a list of mentors on whom you can lean on for support and guidance. Then list out the issues on which you need their help. See, you have to be specific and not vague. You can't expect a very useful response if you just go to them and tell them, sir, I need your help in solving my problems. And when they ask you, what is the problem, sir? It is a business problem. I'm not getting sales. That's not going to really get them involved. Okay. You need to break down that problem and go with sufficient detail. This is what is happening in my sales. This is what I've been doing. These are the numbers. This is how the pattern has been. I do not know what to do about such and such thing. So please go prepared with all relevant information and inputs and seek their advice. Most importantly, you have to ask, okay? You have to ask your mentors, people on whom you can count. Otherwise, no one would know that, even those who can genuinely help you, even they won't know that you need help unless you ask. So this is the second thing with regard to your mentors. Third is your team. Gather your team this week and ask them questions. Try to understand what is their sense of things, what is happening. Share what you think about what is happening. Share what you think is going to happen. Tell them what is happening in your business. So ask and listen and then share with them. Enlist their participation in identifying the threats and blockages. To your business, What are the threats and what are the things that are blocking your business right now? Develop some strategies with them. You know, those guys, they are right in the field, they're right on the ground, they have the ears to the ground. So they may give you a lot of insights, useful insights, and who knows, you may generate ideas that could launch your business into the stratosphere. Then the next thing that you do is you make a list of things that you can do now, that you can do now in your business, in spite of the current crisis. Now remember that this list will keep changing as the situation changes. Then choose the ones that are likely to have the greatest impact on your business. Let me warn you that you will be tempted to choose the easier ones, but the degree of ease should not be your selection criteria, not in today's scenario. You ought to select on the basis of the amount of positive impact, amount or mass of positive impact that these actions are likely to have in your business. And secondly, the speed or velocity with which this impact will take place, because we want quick results, right? So look at that. Let me tell you, mass into speed in physics is momentum. So you have to create that momentum to come out of this current situation, out of this marshland, this bogey land, okay, and come onto firm ground, from where then you can move faster. Okay, so generate that momentum, do those actions that allow your business to generate this momentum to come out. Next, make a quick plan. You have this list of actions that you're going to do, now plan how you're going to do it. Divide this task into subtasks, okay, but do it quickly. Do not make an elaborate plan, do not keep planning, okay, do not overanalyze. So include what you will do and how you will do it and when you will do it. Set your time limits also, please. Limit your horizon to 90 days only. You don't need an elaborate plan, like I have told you again and again. So don't invest too much time in that. Right now, it is more important to act and act fast. And finally, start executing your plan. Execute it with fierce determination and unstoppable drive. Be proactive. Being proactive, okay, so this is my final advice to you. Being proactive, that is the way to engage in the VUCA world. Be proactive, that is the only way. You have to boldly move towards these four horses of volatility. Don't run away from them, move towards them. Volatility, uncertainty, complexity, ambiguity. Move towards them, embrace these horses. And let me tell you, when you are fearless, these horses also notice that you are courageous. They notice your courage and they respect it. No, that was not the last advice. There's something else that I should tell you. Okay. Now, see, if after doing everything, there you could be in a business that is still slowing down and which is likely to slow down in the short term. For example, I have friends in the travel business. Yes, it's a challenge. It's likely to stay a little slow. So to them, I suggest that they could use this time for the stuff that they always wanted to do, but which they have been shoving to the side. For example, proper planning, developing strategy, content curation, maybe start some HR initiatives, do some financial analysis. So these are the things that some of the businesses, which are likely to stay slow for some time, they can devote their time and effort towards. Okay. And doing fun and innovative activities, they can be a great distraction while keeping your team engaged and adding long-term value to the business. One of my clients, he has a team of about 60 people. Okay. And during the lockdown, he was having tambola with them twice in a week. And when he asked me to join, I thought, how do you play tambola? Not on a screen, not on a WhatsApp group, but they had introduced so many innovation. It was so fun. So I'm telling you, there's a lot of innovative ideas that you can come up with. Okay. Now, yes. Anup Mishra, yes. Atul Kakkar, yes. Ram Patil, yes. Murli, okay. So there's so many people who would like to know what happened in that operation. Sonali, do we have some time? Or have I crossed my time?
No, of course, you can carry on.
Okay. I've crossed my time. I can see that. Sorry. Okay. So what happened in that operation? Okay. We got delayed. By the time we reached that general area, it was nearly 10:30, 11. Broad daylight. The rain had stopped early in the morning. The ground was still soaking wet. And so the original idea was that when the militants come out, terrorists come out in the morning to do their morning evolution, we could observe them and then see where they're going back and thereby locate their hideout. Makes it much easier. If we were to just go and start searching around in the bushes, in the jungle, it will be very difficult. And in any case, they would come to know of our presence and they would scoot away from there. So it was important that we moved in the hours of darkness before the first light, take position at various places, observe, let the terrorists come out, let them go back, and then get ourselves together, share whatever we had observed, make a guess or locate the hideout, and then create a plan right there on what we would do, how we would handle those terrorists. Okay. Now, we did not know exactly how many terrorists were there, but by the time we reached there, like I said, it was already daylight. So we slowly started taking position in that area. We used the trees and bushes to stay in cover so the terrorists could not see us. And good luck. Because it had rained and it was so cold the previous night, and because the sun was out and it was so tempting to sit and sunbathe and bask in the sunlight, the terrorists could not resist it. So by the time we crept into position, we saw these guys sitting on different rocks, okay, and enjoying the sun. So our day was made. Now imagine if we had given up the previous night, that because we cannot make it in time, it's futile, let us go back. We did not do that. We reached there in position much later, but in a much better situation. We did not have to search for these guys. They were sitting right there. Okay. We did not have to search for the hideout. Mind you, entering a hideout is dangerous because it's narrow, and when we are moving in, it is only one person ahead. So the persons or persons who are inside the hideout in the cave, they can really, you know, cause a lot of casualties to this team of mine. But that did not happen in this manner. We got these guys sitting ducks, and within moments, tuck, tuck, tuck. So three terrorists were eliminated. And after that, we started looking for their hideout. Now it was so much safer. We took our time, located the hideout, went inside, found a lot of ammunition, weapons, etc. A very successful operation without any casualties. So this is what happened. And it was a pleasure being here with you. I'm done with my webinar. And Sonali, if you could share the questions that people may have asked.
Thank you so much, Rahul. Thank you for such a wonderful session. It was absolutely incredible to hear your real life experiences and listen to you talking about such an informative topic. Thank you so much once again. I'm sure all our attendees really enjoyed and learned something from your session as well. One thing Mr. Atul Kakkar is actually saying, can you please show the slide of volatility once again?
Yes, yes. In fact, what I can do is, see, there's no point seeing slides. You share your email address and I'll send you the slide deck. No problems. I will even share you my notes. Not an issue. Is that okay. Fine, Atul? Yeah. Okay.
And everyone is asking.
Own, Just a moment, Sonali. My own email is very simple. It is connect@kernelrahul.com. I'll also type it for you guys. Okay. So you can just drop in a mail, say webinar, BizDex. You don't have to write any introduction or any of those things. You don't have to even request me for my presentation. You just type in WebEx webinar and I'll send you my slide deck as well as my notes. And I think that should be good.
Yes, perfect.
Oh, no. BizX. This is a BizX webinar. Okay. Sorry. So not WebEx. Say BizX webinar. Type that and send me a mail. Okay. So you don't have to make any introductory or make any formal communication. BizX seminar, even if that is a subject heading of your email, I'll send you the slides. Not an issue. Yes. Sorry, Sonali. You're saying something.
I was just saying the same thing. So wonderful. That's actually great to all our attendees. We have shared the email ID in the chat box. Please just go through that. And now we can go up to the question and answers. So the first question is from Mr. Dibesh. He says, what are the most crucial elements of taking the business from 60% to 100% back on track considering the current scenario?
Okay. See, now Dipesh, you're a lucky person that your business has moved from wherever it was to 60%. Now is the question of reaching that 100%. Okay. Let me also tell you here that this movement from 60 to 100 will take more effort than it were taken from coming from 0 to 60, as it happens in any kind of test that you would have given as a student. That few things that I would like you to focus on. Number one is your business is about revenue and profit. Okay, revenue and profit, not just revenue. So if you're making revenue, a lot of it, but not sufficient profit, that is the problem. So focus all your efforts on those activities, those actions that actually increase your business, that actually directly contribute towards generating revenue. What are those? Marketing, sales. But sales and marketing also, you will have to do it in more intelligent way and in a different manner. Marketing, of course, you have to move more to the digital platforms. Use digital marketing more than you were doing ever before. But at the same time, you need to change your attitude of your marketing and sales. You need to become more of a problem solver rather than somebody who's trying to sell a product or a service. You need to become somebody that I can trust, to whom I can trust in order to make a purchase decision. So you have to take on the role of becoming an advisor to me, to your customers. Share more and more information. Let me also tell you that because of this digital communication, there is a glut of information, and your information that you are sharing has to stand out. Everybody is, you know, pushing posts on Facebook, WhatsApp, sending emails. Everybody is doing the same things. You need to stand out. And therefore, your communication, the messaging that you're doing, has to be positive. It has to be oriented towards solving my problem. You have to step up and say, Rahul, in case you're having this problem, I can help you solve it. And this is how I do it. These are the things that I do it. And this is how I'm able to do it better and faster. So that is the thing that you need to focus more on your marketing and sales. The next thing that you need to do is look at your costs, because that affects your profit. When I say cost, I do not mean your manpower cost, okay? There's so many other hidden costs that are there in your business. Look at those. Reduce your cost of transaction. Reduce the cost of getting your clients or serving your clients. There are a number of places where you can do that, and that can increase your profit. Third thing, in case you are in a situation where you are in an industry or a product which is facing serious challenges, you should start looking at pivoting your business. You start looking at your business model. Even some of you may even need to look at a different product. You continue with the current product, fine, but you also need to start looking at the possibility of developing different product, different service, and a different business model even. So like I said, 60 to 100 is going to be a challenge. It's not just a matter of hard work or working harder that you do the same thing again and again and you'll reach there. No, you have to do things a little more smartly. I hope I have answered your question. Otherwise, email.
Absolutely, wonderful.
Yeah, Sonal.
So the next question is from Mr. Atish, and he is simply asking, what kind of coaching do you offer?
Okay, so like you can see, I'm part of Action Coach. This is the world's largest coaching company. We have coaches all over the country in all different kind of geographies. So wherever you are, you have a coach close to you. You can also take services of off-site coaching. That is, in case you are not in my place, like I am in Ahmedabad. So I coach here in Ahmedabad. We have a fantastic team in Delhi, Mumbai, Pune, Bangalore, so many places. Okay, if you go to our website, you'll get the details. In case you're looking for off-site coaching from me or on C2's coaching here in Ahmedabad, then I provide one-to-one coaching. All of us, in fact, all of us provide this one-to-one coaching where we deal with one business owner focused on his business, and we coach him as per his situation that prevails in his business. And so this is a more personalized, more custom-made thing. And it is focused on, it's more surgical, let's say. Okay. And so obviously this is the best ROI and it is the best results. The next one is the group coaching, where we coach business owners in a group. Basically it is done in order to bring down the cost for the business owners, because if they are not able to afford one-to-one, then this is a more suitable way of taking our coaching. Some of the business owners may like to, you know, take us for a test drive. So they would like to test us, and group coaching is a good way to test that, of what value we bring to the table and whether it is useful to you or not. And third is trainings, which are generally online in today's scenario. In trainings, what we are doing is we are conducting this kind of webinars, a series of webinars, and each one of us is an expert in his or her field. We have certain coaches who are expert in finance domain, others in marketing. So sometimes we get together and conduct a training, and sometimes we do it on our own. Okay, so these are primarily the three things: trainings through seminars and webinars, second is group coaching, and third is one-to-one coaching. Please visit our website, Action Coach India, and you'll get a whole lot of information. My own website is very simple, www.colonelrahul.com. Yes, please.
Perfect. Since we are short of time as well, I think we'll just wrap up the Q&A session now. And thank you so much.
Sonali, there is one gentleman from Nigeria here. Atul Kakkar is from Nigeria. Thank you. Great, Atul. Great having you here. I hope you enjoyed the session. And whenever next you are in India, let's meet up. And while you're in Africa, we can definitely meet up on Zoom. Thank you, Sonali. Sorry for interrupting. Thanks for all the support. Fantastic. And thanks to BizX for giving me this opportunity. I really thoroughly enjoyed interacting with you. And we can continue this interaction in case people want to do it and if they have any questions. Thank you. Bye-bye, Sonali.
Thank you so much once again. Thank you to all our attendees as well. We really hope we were able to add value to your lives through the session. And I'm sure in this case, we were able to do that. So that's wonderful. Thank you so much. If you have any questions, anything you would like to ask me or to Mr. Rahul, please get in touch with me or him. I'll make sure your queries go straight to him. And we really hope we can help you forward as well. Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.